I want to welcome you today to worship. Thank you for choosing to join with us today, both Flint Hill family and all the visitors who are joining with us as well. I am so thankful that the church is not confined to a building, that we can worship in our homes, we can worship right where we are, and I invite you to do that with us today. Will you pray with me as we begin? God, I do thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, that your Holy Spirit is with us at all times and in all places. And God, I am thankful that your Spirit can speak to us now. And so I pray that you will bless us today as we worship you together. God, as we open your word together in just a few moments, I pray that you will speak to us from your word. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
This is Mother's Day, and many of you know my story, and my mother passed away when I was 7, and I've had many people in my life who have taken up the mother role for me, but this is for my mother-in-law who just embraced me and loved me as her own, and so this is for you, Linda.
Up in the air, know their creator, and nature sings an awesome song of praise. Even the heavens declare his glory. so I can stand before you and say that I know him. I know him. I met him at the foot of Calvary. I know him. I know him. First of all, he knows me. He's moving in this place right now. I feel him. I do believe he's standing in the aisle. With outstretched hands, he beckons to the weary. Come, I'll give you rest, my child. For you see, I've rested in his arms a million times or more. And each time he's held me tenderly, so I can stand before you and say I know him. Won't you stand with me and agree that I know him? I know him. I met him at the foot of Calvary. I know him. I know him. Best of all, he
to invite you today, if you will, to take your Bibles wherever you are. Take out your Bible or open your app on your phone. Some people, that bothers them, especially in this day and age. It doesn't bother me at all, but I want you to look at the Word so the Word can feed your heart today. And we're going to be reading today from Joel chapter number two. I know that today is Mother's Day, and although Mother's Day is not found in our church calendar, oftentimes we as pastors, we feel compelled to speak about mothers or about women on this day, but I'm being led differently today. Started a little over a week ago, everywhere I turned, it seemed that Joel chapter number 2 just kept coming up. And as I prayed over the course of the past week, it actually started last Sunday, God began to speak to my heart and say, I want you to preach this message. And the title of this message today would be Sound the Alarm. Sound the Alarm is what Joel's message is for us today. So as you take your copy of God's Word, I want you to read with me today from the inspired and authoritative Word of God, Joel chapter 2. I'm going to read verse number 1, and then we're going to skip down to verse number 12. Joel chapter 2, verse 1.
Blow the horn in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the residents of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. In fact, it is near. Skip down to verse number 12. Even now, this is the Lord's declaration. Turn to me with all your heart, with fasting, weeping, and mourning. Tear your hearts and not your clothes, and return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in faithful love, and he relents from sending disaster. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him so you can offer grain and wine to the Lord your God. Blow the horn in Zion. Announce a sacred fast. Proclaim an assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the aged. Gather the children, even those nursing at the breast. Let the groom leave his bedroom and the bride her honeymoon chamber. Let the priests, the Lord's ministers, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, have pity on your people, Lord, and do not make your inheritance a disgrace, an object of scorn among the nations. Why should it be said among the peoples, where is their God? Then the Lord became jealous for his land and spared his people. I remember the first time I ever preached from Joel chapter 2. It was August of 1992. I was to preach a revival in Peachtree, North Carolina. We had buried my grandfather that morning in Hickory, and it's about a 3-hour drive from Hickory back home. And I remember all the way home that day, I was thinking, God, I don't want to go tonight. I don't want to go and preach. I want to be with my family. I want to be grieving. But that night, God had led me to preach from Joel chapter 2 with the title, Sound the Alarm. I never will forget that evening in that little small mountain church in Peachtree, North Carolina. It was as though I were standing back and watching somebody else preach as the Holy Spirit of God preached through me that night. And 18 people were in the altar that night. 12 of them made first-time professions of faith. Now, who can do that except the Spirit of God? In fact, I think I shared that story just a few weeks ago when I was preaching on the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit leads. Well, friend, the message has not changed from 1992 until now. In fact, the message has not changed from Joel's day BC until now. Sound the alarm, God says. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. The day of the Lord is near. When you hear an alarm, what do you usually do? Well, when we hear our alarms in the morning, we jump up out of bed, do we not? Well, what about if it's an alarm of warning? Well, hopefully if we hear a siren coming behind us, we pull over and allow that emergency vehicle to pass. What if it's an alarm on your phone? I remember just a couple of years ago, I was getting ready for our biannual meeting of the Greater Cleveland County Baptist Association. I had to be there that night. I was the moderator of the association at the time. And so as I was getting ready, there was an alert on my phone. My phone was just buzzing like crazy. And it said, tornado warning. I looked out the front windows of our house, and it was as black as night. The trees were swaying like I've never seen them sway before, and it was raining sideways. Sure enough, that warning was real. there was a tornado passing right over my house, or if not right over, it was pretty close. I went outside later to inspect the damage, and there were trees down all around my house. But to show you God's provision for me that day, there was one tree that came down at the end of our house right at my bedroom where I had been standing, and it came within 5 feet of the end of the house. I listened to that warning. I paid attention to that warning. But let me ask you, what happens when warnings go off in your life? Not always are they like the warning at a store when they don't swipe that little magnetic strip just right and you're walking out and the thing starts blaring. Warning, warning, you have activated our inventory control system. Step back and an associate will help you. Have you ever had that happen? Had that happen, and I start looking for somebody that works at the store to let them know I'm not trying to steal this stuff. We pay attention, do we not, to those warnings? Well, what about a warning, a check that happens in our spirit? Do we pay attention to those warnings as well? Well, friend, today I want to sound an alarm. I want to give a warning if I can, because hear me well, the situation and the consequences that we're in today are dire circumstances, and we need to hear this today. The return of Jesus Christ is closer now than it has ever been. Now, somebody might say to me, Pastor, I've been hearing that my whole life, and I'm well advanced in years, that Christ could return any day. Well, friends, it is a true statement that the return of Jesus Christ is closer today than it has ever been. It could be today. It could be tomorrow. You may not see the dawn of another day. And even if Christ doesn't return, our own death is closer today than it has ever been. And so today, I want to hear from the prophet Joel, and I want to sound an alarm because the day of the Lord is near. Now, the prophet Joel might have been called a minor prophet, but hear me, friends, he is only minor because of the length of the book. This is a major message that he has to share. In chapter 1, if you flip back, we're told about his message. He says, "Hear this, you elders, listen, all who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days or in the days of your ancestors?" As I read that, I thought, this global pandemic that we're in, has anything like this ever happened in your day or in the day of your ancestors? There's nobody that I know who is old enough to remember the last pandemic of this type, which would have been in 1918 with the Spanish flu. So no, nothing like this has ever happened in our day or the day of our ancestors. That grabs your attention, doesn't it? You go on down in chapter 1 and it says, "Tell it to your children. Let your children tell it to their children and their children to the next generation." Don't you think that we're going to be talking about 2020 for a long time to come? I mean, those of you who are even younger children will be telling it for years and years to come. Do you remember what happened in the spring of 2020? Do you remember when they closed schools and everything was closed? Restaurants, sporting events canceled. We're going to be talking about this for years to come. I mean, think about it. There's nothing like this that has ever happened in our lifetime. You go on down in chapter 1 and it says, "What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. What the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten." And then it says this, wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Bingo. Now we get to the meat of Joel's message. What was that message? His message was repent. Repent, he says. And then we come to chapter 2, where I want to spend our time together today. Verse number 12 tells us who needs to turn back to God. Did you hear that? Let me read it for you again. This is the Lord's declaration, and this is how you need to turn back to God. Number one, you need to turn to me with all your heart. That's holding nothing back. That is all in. Turn back to God with all your heart. Then it says with fasting. That's not a word that's in most Baptist vocabulary. Fasting. But really what fasting is, it is giving our attention to God, our full attention to Him. Then it says with weeping. We're crying. What were they weeping over? And then the next thing is mourning. What were they weeping and mourning over? It was over their sin, over them turning their back on a holy God. Friends, hear me today. There's a lot of us that have those little G gods that have crept into our life. And if there's one thing this pandemic has done, it has taken those little G gods and it has taken them out of our life. Don't you think it's time we turn back to God? Don't you think it's time that we turn back with our whole heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning? He tells us how we're to turn. Then he tells us that you are to tear your hearts and not your clothes. What is it that needs to be broken before God? God needs a people to return to Him with broken hearts, broken over our sin, broken over our turning our backs on Him. Then you look on down in verse number 16 and 17, and he tells us who it is that needs to return to him. Starts in verse 15, blow the horn in Zion, announce a sacred fast, proclaim an assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation. That's everybody, the whole group. Sanctify the congregation. Gather them all, is what it's saying. Go on down, it says, assemble the aged. That's the older people, that's the elderly, and the children. So, let's think about this. And then it says, even those nursing at the breast, we're talking from infants to the oldest people in the church. It says you need to gather them all. And then it says, go and get the bridegroom and go and get the bride, even the younger couples. So everybody in between needs to turn their hearts back to God. But listen to this. He doesn't stop there. He says, let the priests, the Lord's ministers, weep between the porch or the portico and the altar. It even calls out the preachers and says, you need to be back on your face before God, calling out to God in repentance that He would turn back, that He would relent. This past Tuesday, I had the opportunity to be part of what was called praying on the mountain. And it was an awesome, awesome time. But friends, I can't help but think when I read of verse 17 that the priests are to turn back, that they're to weep. I can't help but think of the story of Fred Lunsford, who was behind praying on the mountain. And Fred tells the story of when he was a five-year-old boy. And he was walking up a dirt road there near his home. And he said, I could hear something over in the laurel thicket. And I knew exactly what Fred was talking about. He said, we called them laurel thickets. I later found out it's called rhododendron. I still call it a laurel thicket as well. He said, a five-year-old boy, I heard that noise and I had to go and investigate. And he said, I found a man laying face down in that laurel thicket and he was making a groaning noise. He said, then I heard his words. And by the way, he said, I recognized, and it was a gentleman they called Uncle Doc, a preacher from that area. And he said, I heard him crying out to God, God, I would rather die right here than to be a powerless preacher. He was on his face in that thicket before God, crying out to God. Friends, that's what we need today. We need some people on their face before God, calling out, crying out to God, God, I would rather die today than to be a powerless Christian. I would rather die today, God, than not have the power of the Holy Spirit on my life. Friend, what kind of revival could we have in America if we had people crying out to God like that? You want to know how big of a God I serve? Friends, I'm just going to tell you, for the last 2 weeks as I've been in this sanctuary preaching to a bunch of empty pews, the Holy Spirit of the living God has come and He stood right here in this place with me, and I can sense His Spirit moving in this sanctuary as I'm here preaching to a camera. And that is awesome. It's wonderful. I told somebody this. I said, the wonderful thing about it is, I believe the Holy Spirit's moving in this sanctuary because there's nothing hindering the Holy Spirit from moving. There's nobody sitting here who's holding back. There's no unrepentant hearts. There's nobody with ought against their neighbor. There's nobody holding on to a grudge. There's nobody holding bitterness and unforgiveness in their spirit. And the Holy Spirit's just moving. Sound an alarm. Hear the warning. Return to God and return in repentance. What happens when you don't heed that warning? Well, my mind can't help but go back to David. You know, when you think about the story of David and Bathsheba, there were some warnings that David should have seen. If you read that story from 2 Samuel, you will read late in the evening, actually back up even before that. It says in the springtime, when it was time for kings to go out to war, David stayed at home. There's mistake number one. Then it says late in the evening, he was on his rooftop and he gazed across and saw a woman bathing. And he kept looking. Mistake number two. Then he sent one of his servants to inquire about her. And they said, that is Uriah's wife. And David said, bring her to me. Mistake number three, married woman. By the way, there's a compound mistake there. They said, that is Uriah, one of your finest soldiers. One of your faithful ones. And David didn't listen. All of these warnings, all of these bells are going off. Sirens are blasting in David's ears and he's not heeding those warnings. If you read Psalm 32 and Psalm 51, you will hear about David and you will hear about his repentance. You will hear about how he is so sorry in his heart. But friends, what if he had just heeded the warning? What about when those alarms were going off? What if David would have just stepped back and said, no, I'm not going to do that. C.H. Spurgeon once said, sin would have far fewer takers if its consequences were immediate. Is that not true? I mean, think about David. There were consequences. 9 months they waited on that baby to be born, and then the baby died. There were consequences, but they weren't immediate. Friends, hear me this morning. If there is anything in this global pandemic, if there is anything that it should have done, it should have caused all of us to awaken our consciences and to take account of our own lives and ask the question, God, what about me? Where am I, God? If there's anything that this pandemic should be doing, it should be sounding an alarm in our spirit that we should turn our hearts back to God. Oh, that prayer time this past Tuesday was awesome. As those men like Dr. Dom Wilton and Dr. Greg Mathis and Dr. Ralph Sexton, Dr. Ronnie Floyd, as they led us in that prayer time for a spiritual awakening and for revival among God's people, I was just blessed to be part of that time. Or, friend, do you want to know where it all starts? You want to know where revival can begin? It begins in our hearts. I used to hear this said often, Lord, send a revival and let it begin in me. But friends, that is so true because that's where it does begin. Every great move of God in history, if you read about it, if you study it, you will find that every great move of God in history began with prayer. And friends, it began with confession of sin and repentance of sin and people turning their hearts back to God. Every great awakening began that way. First, there's confession, then there's repentance, and then God can move in the community. Vance Havner once said, the devil isn't fighting religion. He's way too smart for that. He's producing a counterfeit Christianity that looks so much like the real thing that genuine Christians can't tell the difference. Wouldn't you say that's true in America today? I mean, let's think about it. Let's think about all of the Christianity that is being produced in America today, where people want all of the benefits, but they don't want the confession and the surrender. You know what Dietrich Bonhoeffer called that? Dietrich Bonhoeffer called it cheap grace. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said in his book, The Cost of Discipleship, cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance, baptism without church discipline, communion without confession, absolution without personal confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross. It is grace without Jesus Christ living and incarnate. Cheap grace. Isn't that what many have fallen for today? They want the church and all of the benefits, but they don't want the surrender and the sacrifice. Right now, I'm leading my wife and son in a discipleship journey called G3. I've been able to be part of that with several other groups, with Wesley and Artie first, and then with our staff, and then with Walt and Rodney, and now with my wife and my son. And one thing that keeps standing out in that discipleship study called G3 is this, that it begins with surrender and sacrifice. And you know what I found out? That there are far too many people that they want all of the benefits, but they don't want to start with the hard part. Surrender and sacrifice. You see, friends, we must first give up before we can begin to give in, and certainly before we can give out, we must first give up. But giving up is hard. But don't miss this. That must come first. It must start there. In Matthew 4:17, we read Jesus began to preach. And what did Jesus preach? It says Jesus preached, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." What was the message of Jesus Christ? Repent. You flip on over to Peter at the day of Pentecost. What did he preach? He preached, repent. You turn over to Paul. What did Paul preach? Repent. You go back to the prophets where we are today. What did they preach? They preached, repent and turn your heart back to God. Friends, hear me today. Oh, church, hear me. It is time to sound the alarm and to return to our knees before a holy God, calling out to Him in repentance and begging His forgiveness. Then we can move forward. Then we can pray that God moves. Then we can pray that God heals our land. But friends, hear me today. It starts on our face before God, repenting of our own sin. We must first repent. I want to go back, if I can, to verse number 18. And then I'm going to add verse 19 as well. Because, friends, hear me today, our God is a gracious God. Our God is a loving God. Our God is a God who wants to hear His people pray. And our God wants to hear our repentance. Verse 18 says, "Then the Lord became jealous for His land, and He spared His people. The Lord answered His people, 'Look, I am about to send you grain, new wine, and olive oil. You will be satiated with them, and I will no longer make you a disgrace among the nations.'" God is always a gracious God. God is always a merciful God. God is always ready. When we come to Him in confession and repentance, God offers us grace. But hear me today. Confession must come first, and then repentance. Friends, genuine confession will lead to genuine repentance. But hear me today. Confession is not necessarily repentance. Confession is agreeing that you have sinned. Repentance is saying, "I'm going to change." Repentance is the Greek word that means to change, and it's actually change your mind or change your heart. There has to be change take place with repentance. In The Cost of Discipleship, Bonhoeffer puts it this way. He talked about cheap grace, but then he talked about costly grace. Standing in contradiction to that cheap grace, there is costly grace. And Bonhoeffer said, "Costly grace is the treasure hidden in the field. For the sake of it, a man will go and sell all that he has. It is the pearl of great price to buy, which the merchant will sell all of his goods. It is the kingly rule of Christ, for whose sake a man will pluck out the eye which causes him to stumble. It is the call of Jesus Christ at which the disciple leaves his nets to follow him. Costly grace is the gospel which must be sought again and again, the gift which must be asked for, the door at which a man must knock. Such grace is costly because it calls us to follow. It is grace because it calls us to follow Jesus Christ. It is costly because it costs a man his life, and it is grace because it gives a man the only true life. And friend, hear this concluding statement today. It is costly because it condemns sin. And it is grace because it justifies the sinner. It is costly because it condemns sin. And it is grace because it justifies the sinner. Will you pray with me? Oh God, my prayer is today that we hear the alarm, that we see, God, the warnings all around us, that it's not them, God, it's not the outside world, it's not they who need to turn back. It is your people, your church, yours, God. We are the ones who need to return to you. We are the ones who need to fall on our face. We are the ones who need to repent. We are the ones who need to confess before you, God. It is us. It is me. It is me, oh God, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh God, standing in the need of prayer. And so God, my prayer for us today is that we will do that very thing. God, that your church, your people, will fall on our face before you in repentance, and we will ask your forgiveness, God, for where we have gone astray, where we have followed those little g gods, where we have not put you on the throne of our heart. God, forgive us, I pray. Oh God, I pray for revival. I pray for a great awakening. But God, I know for that to happen, it must begin with your people returning to you in confession and repentance and committing our lives to follow after you daily. God, hear our prayer now. Prayers of confession and prayers of repentance. In Christ's name. Well, friends, thank you once again for joining with us today. And I've issued a challenge today. I've issued a challenge that we sound the alarm about a need for repentance, about a need for confession of sin. And I just want to ask this. Have you done that? Have you repented of your sin? First of all, have you repented of sin and asked Christ to be your Lord and Savior? And secondly, if you are a believer in Christ, how is your prayer life and how is your repentance? Because even as believers, we need to do that daily. We need to confess our sin before God. We need to lift our hands to Him and say, I surrender to you. And that's difficult at times, but we need to do that. If you've made a decision today, I ask if you will to let me know. Email me here at the church and at pastor@flinthillbaptist.org, and I would like to know of any decision that you've made today. But I also want to encourage you in this. I want to encourage you in your daily prayer time, And I want to encourage you to be praying for revival and spiritual awakening in America. God bless you all. Thank you for joining with us today in worship.